audience.
Festival Mumbai brings you Parsis. Other learning is an SR initiative that fosters creative learning across the fields of literature, culture and heritage, art, visual, performing and applied through various platforms that include workshops, lectures and panel discussions. Having reached about 10,000 interested learners with over 100 unique workshops, events and programs last year, this year has had a very exciting start. At the Jaipur Literature Festival, I have presented a panel in the artist's eye with Homi Bhabha, Glenn Murray of MoMA, Mark Quinn and Billy Kentridge. I would also present the Speakers Forum at the India Art Fair in Delhi, followed by a Successful Approaches to Art Management workshop with Australian faculty Dr. Joe Cost. Last month, we had Gauthi Bombay with conservation architect Abha Narayan Dhamma, Siddharth Bhatia and Christopher London, and the relaunch of Christopher's iconic book, Bombay Gauthi. We also celebrated the launch of Amit Chaudhary's book, Calcutta, 2 years in the city. This month, Apple will be supporting the Hatch for the second year at Art Dubai from 20th to the 23rd of March. The April program will include a photography archiving workshop, a series of writing workshops with Writing Through Movement with UK Elias, food writing with Rishi Nagiriyar, and comedy writing in Delhi with Anubhav Pal. Next month, the Apple Children series will go further with the Little Chefs workshop. As knowledge partners to Focus Festival Mumbai, Abbott has created 2 photography workshops with Himanshu Seth that will include the launch of the Abbott Children Series. This evening, we have Sooni Taraporevala and Mira Nair coming together once again to celebrate Sooni's show, Parsis. I'll now call on Chirin to make the introductions, please.
Good evening. Introduction to Sooni and Mira seems a bit disturbing to do. I should be introducing myself. But nevertheless, Mira and Sooni go back to 1976 when they met in their junior and sophomore year in Harvard. One of those rare friendships that found its way to a highly successful partnership of scriptwriter and filmmaker, whose success has now been historic. A super opportunity to have Mira here in our midst, where Sooni's show coincides with Salaam Bombay re-release tomorrow, where we grab the opportunity to invite Mira to have the ongoing conversations that we are privileged to be privy to. I call upon Mira and Sooni. And not having chairs was a conscious decision on our part, just because we didn't want to litter it too much. So in case there are some older people, could I request the young pintos of the world to
there is space up front for 2 teachers, anybody doubt?
Can I put mics here? Do we need mics?
Yep.
Salaam, namaskar, good evening everyone. Welcome to an incredibly biased and love fest between Sooni and me. I'm really like brimming with pride to be here surrounded by 25 years of her work. This morning, I flew in last night, and this morning I saw at 6 a.m. in a non-jet-lagged state the first time the catalog, and I have to say that I was a puddle of tears because I was so moved by the extraordinary breadth and depth and vision that we see around us and that I have been fortunate enough to have known since we were undergraduates at the age of 18. There are 3 remarkable things about my friend Sooni. One, that she is extremely quiet, steadfast, and pursues in an unsung fashion what her heart tells her to do. She is the most delightfully unambitious person I know. She works without thinking of reward. And lastly, and of course it's not lastly, but in the manner of introduction, a remarkable artist who pursues two parallel tracks of expression, photography, image making, and screenwriting and filmmaking, with the same rigor and same practice and the same, I think, excellence, which is quite rare. I actually don't know anyone who is a photographer and a filmmaker in that way. So what is extraordinary is that she doesn't pursue, as I said, she's not ambitious. So in fact, even this show, I have to say in front of Shirin, I'm sure she knows this, that she, Sooni, moaned and groaned about having this show for almost a year, thinking, yaar kon aayega, who will come, why, you know, what am I doing, why? And I just thought it was an extraordinary opportunity to go back through more than 25 years of her shooting to bring back and restore images that we might have not seen in the seminal book that is now seminal of the Parsis that we all love and know. In fact, Sooni, I don't know if you remember, but when Sonia Gandhi finally talked about the terrible rape in Delhi, behind her was the Parsis, the book. So I was saying, kuch to taste hai. So, you know, anyway, but I just, in interest of this discussion, which I hope will soon be open to all of you, I'd love to know, because I actually don't know, when you got your first camera and how you began that pursuit.
Okay. Thanks, Mira, for asking. As you said, it's not a biopic, it's a biopic, but thank you so much. I got my first camera when I was, I think, 19 years old as a sophomore. I had a small Instamatic, with which I used to take the fall colors and all the usual stuff, and I found it very lacking, found a need for a better one. So I used to work in the music library. Both Mira and I worked a variety of jobs.
Sooni was the skinniest and the most beautiful security guard that Harvard has ever known. The medals on her epaulettes were weighing more than she did. And she didn't protect any institution at all.
So it was at one of those jobs. And he encouraged me to buy a camera, so I borrowed money from my roommate, Kathy, to buy, and bought a Nikon, which was the lower-range camera that Nikon made. But it was an SLR, and it was my first-year camera. And I had that till it was stolen in Spain, I don't know, many years later.
But when I remember, because we both started pretty much together when I arrived in college, I came as a transfer student from Delhi University, and Sooni was already there a year before as a freshman. And I asked the question that every Indian asks when they leave their country: how many other Indians are here? And there were only three at the time. Sooni was one of them. Anand Mahindra was the second, and Anil Diolalikar, bless him, was the third. And I rapidly went across Ratcliffe Yard to find the only other Indian female, and found Sooni. And I'm, you know, just grateful for the incredible boon. I was trying to count how many years. It's almost coming to 30 years since we were crazy together. But the funny thing was, you started photographing. I remember the first show, you went to the Pyrenees, right? And you came back and actually exhibited these black and white pictures of the Pyrenees in Cambridge somewhere, right?
And how at the Carpenter Center, at the Dark Room, they had a kind of showcase. My teacher, those were the first real pictures I took that were decent, and she put them up, and for that I'll always be grateful. So that was my first show.
Well, it was coming full cycle, because in a few months ago we were together back at Carpenter Center, where we had both gone to school, and there was an extraordinary, thanks to the Tatas, an extraordinary show, kind of half this show at Carpenter Center, and a lot of our film professors and contemporaries and people who had either, you know, not dyed their hair or dyed their hair were there. And And it was fantastic actually coming together. And Iana, your lovely daughter, was with you. And you know, there's a method to what was insanely mad at that time. And after the Pyrenees, I mean, the thing, you, I remember you took a semester off to come to India to photograph, right? You took one picture or two pictures in the 3 months?
I came because I was homesick, but I said I was coming to photograph to justify myself. Your dad, who was horrified.
Yeah. Okay. My dad, by the way, used to call her a rudderless ship. And still call, well, he passed away last year, but he always called her a rudderless ship or Looney Sooni. I wish he could see this now.
Yeah. So I came here to take pictures and ended up with actually only two pictures that were missing. And one of them is here on the wall, which is my earliest picture. The picture of the Taj, from the Taj of the Gateway of India. So that's my earliest picture. And I think it's lovely that Mira was staying in the Taj yesterday. And I think it's really lovely how life comes to
someone. That's amazing, yeah. We, you made that picture and then you came back, but you never gravitated towards majoring in visual studies like mm-hmm. I did. And why was that? I mean, why didn't you go there?
I always, I think, took the kind of tangential path rather than the direct path. So I was actually studying photography. I was doing photography, but only as independent courses, so I could do my own work and use the facilities like a dark room. And same with film, I was studying film, and I took two courses in filmmaking. But all these were very indirect routes to what I actually ended up doing, which was photography and screenwriting.
But you were not screenwriting then. I remember these short stories you would write about living in Bombay and Chappie's, you know, the Chappie's home and short stories. And it was actually those stories which were so nimble, I thought, that led me finally when we came back here. Well, you came back, Sooni came back after graduation. You went to NYU, right? And you, I think it was just a way to stay abroad, right? But and at NYU you had an exhibition, right?
At NYU I was in a group show where evenings at Cozy Building and some of the more personal pictures of my family I exhibited at that time.
And then you returned to India to become a photographer, and I remember at that time it was in the mid-80s, right?
No, 82.
I remember you were toiling and going to Namaskar offices and Signature offices and various magazines. I don't know if I'm troubling anyone in the audience with these memories, you know, taking pictures for magazines and hoping that you'd get paid in the next year to come or something. So it was pretty dire in terms of making a livelihood.
Absolutely. In those days, everything was expensive, cameras, film, processing, and you never got paid on time. It was quite terrible. So I was actually very relieved and happy when I found I had another career as a screenwriter and I didn't have to depend on photography. And that's actually the best situation to be in, where you can do something you love for the love of it and not to make a living. It's a real luxury and I'm very lucky, thanks to you, to have that luxury.
Well, But I also wanted, you know, when I was looking at the catalog and when I know the work so intimately, but it really is 25 years of photographing, not just the Parsi community, but Bombay, this amazing largesse of the city that you have loved and known. And I wondered, you know, this is what's so baffling about you, Sooni, is that outside you look like you don't care, koi ambition nahi hai, you know, you're just happily to chill. You're not going to design, you know, your path. You're going to have a show and then you're going to have a book and then you're going to have another book and then you're going to have a Swiss gallery and then you're going to have additions and then you're not like that. I mean, you're so like out of that scene. And so what I marveled at was the consistency of the photographing, whether anyone knew you were, whether you were showing the work. How does that happen? I mean, how did you keep yourself going even though photography was not a beloved art at that time in the early 80s in India?
I just enjoyed taking pictures.
Yeah.
That's what kept me going. And in those days, it was very hard to share photographs. You could only share them if you published a book or if you had a show. And now I just love it that it's so freely shared photographs. I'm on avid Instagram, and I have many Instagram friends. And I love iPhoto, I love the net. I love being able to just whisk pictures across, you know, around the world. But question. It was just, I enjoyed taking pictures of that type of course. And I guess I just took them and I kept them. And thanks to Sri Dhanu, and thanks to the Tatas, I had this amazing opportunity to actually air them and bring them out and, you know, print them in the best possible way and show them this wonderful space.
I also have a memory of you in the, I think 1980 it was, I was married to a wonderful photographer, Mitch Epstein, and we, through Mitch, we used to go, you and I, to all these fancy gallery openings of photographers of Eggleston and Gary Winogrand and Lee Friedlander and all the greats, really. And I remember us, you know, looking like we were dedicated outsiders in the art world in New York. How was it for you when you saw that world? Yeah. What did it feel like? Did it fuel you in any way? Or
quite the opposite, actually. It was not a world that I was really interested in. In fact, I once saw some pictures in New York of the Red Light District in a pristine gallery, and I just thought it was so... the disconnect was too much for me. I couldn't get over the context and what the pictures were. So, no, actually, the art world has never actually fueled me. But, I mean...
Now you're in it, baby.
I'm actually quite loving it.
As you should, it's the most extraordinary show. I just want to come to this confluence, which is quite rare, as we know, of image making and screenwriting. And of course, the extraordinary thing for me is the screenwriting with you is so visual, you know, because we kind of have similar, obviously, sensibilities, and we both are attracted to the weird and to the idiosyncratic and to the eccentric and to the whimsical as well, and not to what people consider traditionally beautiful or so on. And just to remind ourselves of the first time that, you know, you hadn't written anything screenplay-wise, I hadn't made a fiction, I hadn't studied fiction film. And I asked Sooni, we've always been, I like to think of ourselves as our security blankets, you know, mutual security blankets. And I had made a film on strippers in Ghatkopar, living in Antofi, as this gentleman here reminded me. And it's a film called India Cabaret, and it was asked to open the India International Film Festival in Hyderabad. And documentaries were hardly seen those days, but this film, it was 1,500 people, I remember, because everyone thought it was sex. And when there's sex selling in 1980s in India, you know, all the men in the world come out of the woodwork. So they thought it was a sex fest, but it turned out to be this pretty bawdy but frank documentary about women who are dancers, who have a great sense of humor and rightness about what they do. And Sooni was with me because it was a terrifying moment. And we saw that the language of Bombay that was used in the film was so powerful and impactful in the audience. And it was a language that you don't get in Indian cinema, especially those days. And I remember distinctly us being in the audience together and immediately there and then thinking that we should now go off and make what was and then became Salaam Bombay. So, you know, I just remember this extraordinary gift that you had, both for understanding children and writing dialogue that was so much about how people are, and of course your beloved Bombay. So what was, I mean, I remember these mad years we spent making that film, but, and then you made these amazing still photographs about, with that film, and by the way, we have a book that just is coming out this week on the making of Salaam Bombay. It was a reissue of the book we did, but it has amazing photographs by Sooni, as well as her extraordinary screenplay. And what was that transition like? What was that like for you from, you know, the photography world into the writing world?
Like I said, you know, I came to it very indirectly, but because I've studied film so much and watched so many films, that I think I instinctively kind of knew what to do. But I'm glad I didn't study screenwriting per se, because I find that sometimes when you do that, there are formulas and, you know, traps that you might fall into. So both of us being as quirky as we are, the script ended up being not a formulaic film, but actually quite quirky, because that's the way we are, I think. And both, I think you and I really love the real world and really take sustenance from it. And I think that's also what makes us vibe together so much, that we're always fascinated and marveling at, you know, what the real world can draw, that fiction cannot even dream of.
The truth is always more peculiar than fiction can ever dream of. Yeah, that's super true. I mean, just to share with you, like a screenplay like The Namesake, you know, which was from an extraordinary novel we know from Jhumpa Lahiri. But, you know, Sooni would, I would come back and find new scenes that she had written. And there's this one scene that she wrote, well, it was deeply emotional, but it was written kind of like a photograph, and it was not from the film, from the book. It was the scene which, when after Gogo loses his father, and he comes back in this airport, and he's shaved his head, which was Sooni's invention, it was not in the book, and the mother receives him, and the mother hugs him, and he says, and she says, "You didn't have to do this." And he says, "I wanted to do this." And I remember that evening coming back in New York and putting on my computer and seeing this scene, actually seeing the scene like in front of me because of the way you wrote it photographically and of course emotionally, but I was just finished. I just was deeply affected. And so it's like that with us, or with you really, in terms of how you, the visual quality of the world really, you know, seeps into, or is the foundation sometimes, I think, of the way you write. Would you say that? Would you, how do
yeah,
you?
Yeah, I think so. I think so. I think with Salam Bombay, I was really, I really wanted to explore the city and put the kids in the context of the city. And I think our invention of a character who doesn't speak the language really helped us. With Sona Sal, doesn't speak Hindi, really helped us. Everything that she did, or all interactions with her, had to be purely visual, without any dialogue. And I think dialogue is minimal. I mean, it is there, but it's not full of dialogue. And I remember one scene, which was the graveyard scene, had 3 pages of dialogue, which was the longest. And we cut it down. And now I see scripts with, you know, full of scenes, it's just not my style.
Yeah. Also, because I think we came to film from the States first, and then, you know, the combination of India and the States, and not really wanting to have people read our films rather than, you know, see or experience our films. This real sort of effort, even after the screenplay was written, to minimize the dialogue so it doesn't become a subtitled experience. That's the ghost of the gallery saying stop now, it's boring. So that also lent itself to, you know, being much more, having much more integrity with the visual universe rather than the reading the words universe. So now, you know, now that you have this extraordinary, really extraordinary show, I also want to ask you one more thing, which is that the portraits that we have in this show are really amazing. And I've just come from being photographed because we're opening the movie. And, you know, the way people take pictures commercially, portraits are so, it's so against the essence of what the person is. But when I see your portraits, it's really extraordinary. I mean, not just of Mama, your grandmother, whom I adored, and your own family, whom I loved and knew each one of, but also of others. You know, how do you do that? How do you actually do that?
Well, with minimal equipment for one thing, so you don't overwhelm someone with, you know, lights and long lenses, and just talk as we're talking, try to make them feel less comfortable. I think when people feel comfortable with you, then they relax, and then it's not such an ordeal.
Can you talk to us also about your influences photographically? I mean, who were the people who made you excited, and did you meet any of them? Did they impact your work directly?
The first person, my longest lasting influence has been Cartier Bresson. And I never met him. I sent him my book, I got a postcard back from him, which is my most precious possession. So his work has definitely, I have loved and continue to love. And funnily enough, I'm thinking about it, a lot of them are French, you know, Brassai, Italy, Alger, those photographs of Paris, Robert Frank, the Americans. More, I guess, you could call them more classical work, just old fashioned.
But talk to us, you know, I know how much of a role Raghubir Singh, who was our dear friend, played in putting you on the path of making the Parsis.
Okay. So, when I came back in 82, I met Raghubir. You introduced me.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Long distance, because you knew him, which I knew. So, you introduced me and I went to see him, and I had my pictures with me, fingerprints of various stuff I had done, including the various pictures, and then pictures of my family, and some other Parsi pictures. And he looked at all of them and he said, you know, we should concentrate on doing something on Parsis, because it hasn't been done before, and we don't have any access. And that's when I started working towards a book, and he was extremely helpful. Every time he came, he would loan me lenses, he would loan me his films, etc. And he would always see the work and critique it. And a small word of praise from him was huge.
And rare.
He was a man of the world. So I always kind of dreaded to show the work, but I always also did show it to him. And my friend Nithi Shetty's film was also mentored by him. Both of us owe him a great deal.
It was really sad when we lost him so
young. I also started shooting in color after that. And of course, he is the maestro of color photography. And so I learned a lot from him, looking at his pictures, his color picture.
So what do you feel like when you see this 25 years of work, not just the photography, but the, oddly enough, the movie that's re-releasing this week? I mean, how is that amazing? Is it, I mean, it keeps me beyond words, but how do you feel about
it
finally?
It is really surreal, actually. I feel blessed and lucky, but I think the key word is surreal, that it's all come together and that it's in our movie tomorrow. You know, everything, it's amazing. And you know, the stage, Shireen, Tata's, everything was just so easy for the show to happen. Blessed, that's what I was saying. I'm blessed to have a friend like
you. Oh, ho, ho, ho. Well, I just wanted to open it up to conversation with the audience. I'm sure you have questions for Sooni, and if any of you have anything for me.
Salaam Bombay also allowed.
Sorry?
Salaam Bombay questions allowed.
Yeah, yeah.
You brought up the chicken.
The chicken.
The chicken that they give us. That is such a sweet name.
I know.
And then she receives it as well with such grace.
Yeah.
So who thought of that chicken? If you haven't seen it, go see the film for the chicken.
Yeah, yeah. And not to mention not just the chicken, but also the slaughtering of the chicken as well. Yeah. Yeah. But I don't remember who thought, you know.
You know,
very,
very nice. Things happen. Yeah. Sometimes I say to people, as you know, you're a writer, characters grow, stories grow.
And Salaam Bombay really felt like a collaboration. I mean, even when I watched it, it's been
25 years, yeah.
Hair
color, Zindabad.
When you watch, I remember thinking there's a friendship, and I didn't know either of you, but I felt there's a friendship behind that is keeping this film so warm and intimate and lovely. Just so beautiful. And that
Thank
comes
you.
Across here also. You know, this the energy of the photographer shows up in the audience.
Thank you. I mean, the intimacy, like just now going to the ladies' room here, and I saw that picture of Pilu Auntie looking at the kids in the bathtub, in the pool. I mean, it's fantastic. You know, it's the same, as you said, Jerry, it's the same kind of intimacy that you'd have in the portrait of, let's say, Homi Sethna. You know, it's the same kind of love, actually. But Sooni, the picture of the family in Cozy Building, all the many pictures. You know, I have a beautiful picture of all the four of them on Cozy Building Terrace, and she signed it to me, says to Mira, who knew every single person in this picture. You know, that's the photograph I keep next to my desk at all times. And it is amazing, you know, it sort of to capture something that is also gone, you know, and it's a very ephemeral, you understand, life becomes. And it's beautiful to have had that in this
My grandmother used to adore Mira. She said, Mastana.
Mastana.
A storm has arrived.
Tufan Mail, yeah, that was my name. And I would say to her, how's the nightlife, mama? And she said, nightlife, chodo. Yeah, but we used to, I don't know.
Internationally, any response to the sense of the loss of community, you know, the evaporation of the Parsi as a...
Nobody knows who a Parsi is.
Yes, Mani.
I want to ask you, be greedy and ask you two questions. One is that, how do you think the experience of taking a still photo, the experience of taking a still photograph and capturing something there and a movie, a shot? And the other question is, I don't know whether you've worked a lot in black and white. See, what is the different aesthetic?
Okay, so still photograph versus a movie. Well, it's just, I don't know, I don't seem to compartmentalize them in my head. So I sort of go from one to the other pretty easily without kind of defining them or even thinking about them. So I don't know how to answer that question actually. And about black and white and color, I was telling someone it was quite random actually. It wasn't planned that I would shoot this in black and white and color. It just so happened, whatever film I happen to have, I mean, I shouldn't be saying this. And it was in the days before digital, where you had to actually decide whether it was black and white or color. Now you shoot color, you turn it into black and white, and, you know, you can have both black and white and color. It's a different media.
Other questions?
Yes.
When taking pictures, what makes you decide? Because you know, what you're shooting are common everyday things. When I see it, I see nothing. When you see it, you're seeing something, obviously. So what makes you decide?
It's again hard to define because it's such a visual thing. But I think it's not brain surgery. I think when you practice, it gets easier. Then you look at books, you look at photographs, and you train your eye to see things, and then you start seeing things. So if you want to, for instance, look at a lot of photography books, and then go out onto the street, you would, I think, start seeing things that you don't see now, maybe.
I mean, my inspirations were largely in filmmaking. What really came through photography and understanding kind of how to make a frame, and I learned more first by actually taking the Ben Lifton course, you know, where they show us great photographers and we actually analyze a frame, and the more academic way, you know, to understanding a frame. But for me, it has been my greatest inspiration in making film, where every frame, actually, I always say every frame is sacred, and you must take enjoyment in making each frame. But if I prepare a film, the references I have are usually from photography, you know, and it helps a lot. Well, and other people's visualizations of other things help me communicate my own ideas to my team, let's say, you know, and eventually to the world. So it's interesting how the frame and how to make a frame becomes something, like Sooni said, that you teach yourself to understand, you know, and it is subjective. I mean, what makes my frame would be different from what you make, you know. But it's an interesting rigor that can be learned, but only if it is enjoyed, I think. Yeah.
Of course. Does the sense of balance that you have in every photograph come through in your script writing as well?
You have to ask my director.
Whoa. The ghost is getting exciting. I think that I think that we achieve balance, you know, in the journey of the screenplay. You know, what's really interesting about Sooni's writing is that it isn't. It's always truthful. There's nothing false about it, just like you see in the work. You know, the falsity, the kind of contrivance or forcing for effect or borrowing from somebody else, that is just not there. So, but the balance is, but what is there is sometimes an uncensored writing, you know, of whatever the emotion or the situation is. And then what we do pretty well together is, I think, achieve the tapestry that is finally the balance, you know. And of course, as they say in movie making, you write a movie three times, first in the writing, then in the shooting, and then in the editing. And that tapestry is finally achieved in all the three processes. But it's amazing to imagine a writer or any artist who just naturally doesn't deal with falsity, you know, because we are all so influenced by so many things in the world, and we all can always aspire to become, you know, just nothing is original. So it's easy to go into the realm of striving for something when it's not truthful.
Talents and effortlessness. When you are taking a photograph and you are looking through the viewfinder, you already have your frame complete. Is it that's correct? That the instant where you press the shutter, you already have the picture?
Yeah.
And is it effortless? Or you have to do a little bit of intelligent cropping to show a little hand forward or something like that?
You know, because my major influence was Cartier Bresson, he'd never cropped his pictures. So as a result, I never cropped my pictures. So I don't crop my pictures. In terms of the frame, sometimes, like there's a picture here called Evenings at Cozy Building, it's a single frame, there's nothing. It was just one picture I took and it was correct and it was absolutely dead on. There are other times when I've sensed that there is something, but I'm not getting it, and I take like, you know, six pictures around that situation. Sometimes it results in a good frame, and most often it doesn't.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sooni, I don't know if my mic is working. So you talked about.
I have a rough map in my head always, but I always leave myself open to change. So when I'm writing, I'm always open to change, and Mira is the same way. I think Mira will take a good suggestion from anybody when you're shooting, but at the same time will also stick to the script or whatever her vision is. It's a balance. And in terms of serendipity, you have to be ready to receive the serendipity. So if you're ready to receive it, it comes to you. It's not that you can just always be lucky. You have to also invite that luck sometimes. And you have to practice. I think anything needs practice, and that's true of photography, that's true of writing. The more you do it, the better you become.
Take two more questions, one here.
As a fellow Parsi, you have access to the fire temple, which other non-Parsis don't. So when you took your camera inside, what did the priest say, or did anybody say anything, or they were just doing their own?
The ghost is having a fit.
What is that?
this? What is it?
Hello? First of all, I would always ask. I wouldn't just go in. So I would ask the priest and I'd tell them. And at that time, nobody was really bothered. No one was paranoid. Nobody was bothered. And you were just not allowed to take pictures of the fire itself, which I've never done. Most of these pictures are taken in the hallways outside the main worship area, where they do jasans, which are puja kind of ceremonies. And those are not restricted or didn't used to be. Now I haven't done it in recent times, so I don't know. Yeah, but I did have access, and unfair access that someone who's not a Parsi would not have, which is one of the reasons also why I did this, because I did have access and I did want to document something that might not be around for that much longer. So,
one last question.
I've actually never lost interest in either. I've always been fascinated by the city, and it's an endless fascination. I've always been homesick for it. I've always longed to be back, and I always love it when I land in Bombay and I smell that fetid, humid air. I feel I'm home. So I've never lost my interest in the city. In fact, there's so many areas I haven't explored that I would love to. And in terms of my community, I've grown up in a very large and happy extended family, and I continue to, my parents live in the same house at Gwalior Tank, the neighbors are pretty much the same, so I have a very warm and loving relationship with both, and with Bombay it's more love-hate actually, sometimes.
We'll be charging $100 per session on that. The ghost doesn't want me to answer that question. In the early years, we sometimes did, and it was, I think, sometimes it can get painful over the creative process. But fortunately, I mean, actually, largely, I think, through the example of our families, both Sooni's family and mine, we were all, I don't know, we just worked it out, and it wasn't that serious. There was some pain that would then resolve, and because Salaam Bombay was a very intense experience, you know, both the creation of it, and then the shooting of it, and then the raising of the money, and not having anything, and then actually making it, and you know, and then seeing it come to life, and it was the first for both of us in every single aspect of it. So that's bound to have both the great solidarity and also a sense that maybe, you know, we don't understand, you know, we are sort of on different paths, only at the end of it. But then we came around, and it sort of makes it almost stronger when you have, it's not always, it cannot be all hunky-dory, but I must say we haven't had we are harmonious together. We don't thrive on tension or you know, jealousies or any of that stuff, you know. Yeah, I mean, the director does win, but
that's why I became one.
Yeah, that's why she became one. Yeah, I mean, I always say I'm the most open and collaborative person in the world, like, so long as I have the last word. But, you know, with Sooni, or with any great, you know, writer or collaborator, you have to not just say, it's mine because I want it, but you have to, you know, explain, and you have to say why. And that's also very interesting, because it hones your own idea, you know. But, yeah, that's why movies are made by directors. But it gives me great pleasure, really, to be here and to be, you know, surrounded by decades of great beauty and emotion. And I thank you all for coming. And
thanks
now
so
you join the art world.
There are catalogs for sale, people.
And the movie. Each one take 10 people.
I wanted to ask the question at the end. Half the question to ask, but then...